Welcome to our fifth topic. And in this topic, basically, we want to focus on the many features of the healthcare system service and its relation with economic development. We've already looked at economic development in the previous topic, whereby we looked at the characteristics, its objectives, and what economic development means. So in this, the objective is to that by the end of this lesson, you as a learner should be able to describe health as one of the social sectors with economic implications, also explain the specific nature of the healthcare services. You should also the specific nature to outline the implications of economic development to the healthcare system or services. Then elaborate on the effect of economic on health status of society. Also, we should be able to identify the ways through which improvement of the health system can create conditions for economic development and vice versa. So with this, basically, it's like we're going to have an overview of what health economics would mean to us as a country and look at the main features in terms of the healthcare service. Have it that you find that health economics basically it is the application of economic theories to the concept of economics in the topics of health and healthcare. So since health economics is concerned with issues related to the allocation of scarce resources to improve health, these include both resource allocation within the economy to the health sector and within the healthcare system. Activities and individuals. So in chapter four, rather in our topic four, we were able to look at some of the problems that will result in maybe market failure or issues related to the market of health, and we looked at adverse selection models. We looked at asymmetrical information and also supply induced demand, of which we explained each one of them. You can review that. We also were able to look at the perspectives of health in terms of health, right? Health as a consumption good. We also looked at health as an investment, and also now we were able to look at the distinctive characteristics of the healthcare services from other commodities, in the sense that we looked at issues to do with the free market. Basically first maybe on the market failure, whereby we were able to look at the different characteristics of market failure and what would lead to that. So of which in that case we looked at market failure, problems of risk and uncertainty, looked at equally information whereby like doctors have information, number of treatment of medication and that's like, but the consumers don't have information. We also look at consumers also impact on patient externalities and equity and healthcare. So why not leave healthcare to the market? People believe that you cannot buy and sell healthcare like other goods and services. They believe that healthcare is different. But this is actually something quite common sense approach to the issue. Look at the first activity in our section. We find that economists approach the same question rather than differently, than analyze the question of healthcare and markets from a theoretical perspective. So in general, then, look in detail at the problems that healthcare. After that, we'll look at the issues of equity, again, maybe later at a given point. So we're able to define the market and the market failure, but look at all that, the issues to do with the competition, problems, moral hazards, and such. So I would like us to focus more on the economic scope in terms of the healthcare. We do have the economies of scale, and all these are under the imperfect competition aspect of the free market, where you have monopolies, economies of scale, and such. So with the monopolies, Like you may find that there's a small one firm or one organization that is monopolizing, it is taking the advantage of us, and we do have the economies of scale. Why should the average cost of providing hospital becomes larger? There are a number of reasons. Maybe like a large institution is able to make more of specialization. And these are involved both people and capital, and there's also a large hospital which is able to develop specialist medical units employing both highly skilled surgeons and specialist capital equipment. Such a hospital is also able to employ specialized managers and ancillary staff, which will allow it to operate more efficiently. And again, a large institution is able to achieve purchasing economies of scale through buying, and so a large hospital prevents wasteful duplication of facilities. There will only be a limited number of patients with particular conditions, particular skills and equipment in one area. So concentrating the treatment in one place allows the most efficient use of the resources. What about economies of scope? In many cases, we'll find that it costs less to provide a large a range of services in a single hospital rather than have several hospitals, each just producing one or two services. For example, emergency surgery and treatment of heart attacks are more cost effectively provided in a single hospital rather than two separate ones. Okay, I thought I emphasized on those two aspects before we get into the health services and in relation with the economies or economic development. And with this, maybe we'll focus more about equity. We talked about equitable distribution of resources. And we mentioned that efficiency is not everything, and we're also concerned with what is fair, not just what is okay. With this, the aspect of demand for health services that we need to focus on in terms of health economics. And you see, as indicated from what I've already mentioned, most observers agree that consumer demand are effectively various, are affected by various factors such as more ignorant, tested, and uncertain in their role. As consumers of health services and as purchasers of most other commodities cannot assess the quality and character of the health services they consume and are generally unaware of the variety of healthcare alternatives available for treating a given illness. So ethical standards adopted by the health professionals preclude advertising, so consumers are denied access to this form of information concerning the relative merits and costs of various forms of care and treatment. Moreover, you find that there's reluctance of some physicians to discuss illness in an ethical terms or tends to keep consumers ignorant of feasible treatment alternatives and make it nearly impossible for them to exercise rational choice. So while individuals can choose their physicians, doctors usually determine the kind and quantity of health services individuals consume, while doctors may have some knowledge of the individual's financial resources. These considerations are unlikely to have much influence on the type of the prescribed healthcare prescribed. So consumers are usually lack knowledge concerning the actual need for care, and thus the overall benefit of health services is generally uncertain from the consumer's point of view, and the demand for a significant portion of health services is based on the doctor's judgment. So the demand and need for medical care is always the same. For instance, you find that if an individual may demand more care that is required medically. Conversely, he or she may be able to medical care but may not be aware of its value. So need is generated by the instance of the illness, while demand is generated by the interrelationship of illness with the other factors. So to plan for future use of facilities and personnel, demand rather than need. demand rather than need may be use. It's always a clear cut. For example, there's a distinction between a severe cold and pneumonia. Severe cold and pneumonia, it may not be noticeable to the consumer. Chest pains may indicate bronchitis or a serious heart condition. In such instances, a high income family would be expected greater precautions and thus incur higher medical care compared to a low income family. So, moreover, even after treatment is begun, economic factors may influence its duration. A poor family may decide to forgo the possible benefit from an extra day in hospital or an additional visit to the physician. So, medical care is characterized by a low degree of substitutability. Most medicines are highly specific, and alternative groups are not able to supply the level of satisfaction. So, you find that medical care is generally wanted for its own sake, and most medical care and treatment are pleasant and generally are not wanted until it becomes a preferable alternative to the pain and other consequences of illnesses. And this implies that the price elasticity of demand for medical care will tend to be low. Okay. What about changes in demand in medical care? You find that quantity demanded, we mean that it's the quantity demanded at any specific price. All other cost factors are constant. So by demand, just the set of quantity demanded at various price levels, all other causal factors have constant. Changes in quantity demanded is shown by a movement of the demand curve. Demand is expressed in a shift in the demand curve. In the analysis of demand, medical care, the focus is on healthcare. Hence, the commodity physician care is used as an example. You have income. The consumers generally assume to be possible related to demand. These are aspects that are related to demand as to focus on changes in demand for medical care. So, it's a factor. Income is a factor. We have some factors that are able to affect demand. And one of them is income. We're saying that income of consumers is assumed to be positively related to the demand. That is, if income increases, the quantity demanded at each price will be greater. So, the level of income results in a shift in the demand curve. So, income is a variable and used to measure the ability of the individual to afford medical care. But only an approximate measure. Another measure of the affordability of medical care is the individual's level of wealth, including bank deposits and real estate and assets, less any debt, such as bank loans and mortgages. All these are supposed to measure the individual's ability to pay the medical care. Then you do have the price of related commodities as a second factor. That is, the demand for a particular commodity is also influenced by the quantities of related commodities consumed. So find that the quantities of these related commodities are in turn influenced by their prices. So two classes of commodities, commodity relations, here we do have the complements and substitutes, which you need to read further on. We do have the tests. And these are sometimes been called the ones connecting the intensity of desire for particular commodities and the elements that influence the intensity of an individual's desire for medical care include health status, educational background, sex, age, race, upbringing, etc. So any of these can explain differences in the intensity of desire for medical care among individuals. And that is, other factors remaining constant. These differences offer explanations as to why one individual's demand shifts. Explanation might simply be that the health status of the first individual is lower than that of the second individual. Another aspect on the economic development, we focus on the health and economic development, whereby, remember, we say that development is a concern of every given developing country. We have several questions to ask ourselves to find out if truly development is taking place. Like, what is development? How does it differ from economic growth? How can development measure? And what role does health play in development? And what role should the health worker play in facilitating development? And this subsection will be attempting to provide this as we finish up. All right, then we do have economic development, which you already looked at and looked at some of its objectives. We also looked at growth and development and the differences between the two. How can differentiate growth and development economically in a given country or in a given organization? So interest maybe for now, we shall look at the measurement. How do you measure? How do you measure economic development? Is it measurable in a semica? Yes, it is. The measurement of development has returned social scientists with a problem of finding the suitable tools and techniques to do so and interpreting results of such measures. Several objections have presented for measuring development, and one line of research has suggested the use of the so-called social indicators. And the purpose of this is to measure the well-being of the population by examining factors such as health and nutritional status, level of education, housing conditions, and so forth. However, it is easy to calculate the gross national product, the GNP, per capita incomes, and also growth rates. And as a result, in most reports, these variables are used as indicators of development. Now, economic development, in addition to rise in per capita income, implies fundamental changes. Fundamental changes in the structure of the economy, characterized by a rising share of industry, along with the failing share of the agriculture in GNP and increasing percentage of people who live in cities rather than those in the countryside. Also, passing through periods of accelerating, then decelerating population growth, during which the age structure of the country changes dramatically. Also, can be measured by changes in the consumption patterns. People no longer spend all their income or necessities, but instead they do move on to consume durables and eventually leisure products and services, also meeting the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs, that is sustainability. We also have that this participation, that is mainly by the citizens of the country in the process, as well as the benefit, while economic development in modern economic world involves much more than a rise in capital income, and there can be no development without economic growth. So we do have health implications of economic development. Which ones could be? Find that the association between health and national development are complex. So the interaction is a two-way phenomenon, with health being both influenced by and influencing economic development. So health can influence the economic development, and health can also be influenced by the economic development. So improved health has been considered solely as a result of economic growth, a part of the product of growth rather than one of its causes. So some development experts have maintained that health should have low priority in development funding and have tried to justify opinions with comments such as only a rich nation can afford the programs to assure its population health, or poor nations cannot afford improved health. So the concern of development partners or planners is accentuated by the fact that during the demographic transition, lower rates are often associated with sustained high birth rates, which results in rapid population growth. So while the supply of labor may increase as a result of improved health and reduced birth rates, there may be no corresponding gain in per capita output. Thus, if economic growth is too slow to absorb the additions to the labor force associated with expanded health programs, then greater unemployment, both open and disaster, may result. Thus, improved health in poor societies can be postulated to produce larger populations, greater poverty, and also ultimately deterioration in health. So, however, the development planners and economists are more optimistic regarding the impact of health and nutrition programs on economic growth. And there are three different ways by which improved health programs can accelerate development. One of them is improved health may increase productivity or efficiency of the labor force, leading to greater output and reduced cost per unit of output. Then also better health conditions may serve to open new regions of a country of settlement and also subsequent development. Also, we do have it that attitudinal changes towards achievement and entrepreneurship may be aligned to health and nutrition programs. And this linkage has a significant importance to stimulate entrepreneurship in poor countries. It has been apparent that the conditions are worse, relatively simple and low cost health programs can produce dramatic reductions of debility and disability of the labor force. So in the situations, major increments in productivity are most readily apparent. For instance, in the Philippines, you'll find that at one time, a survey of major enterprises indicated a daily absenteeism rate of 35%, attributed largely to malaria. So after initiation of an anti-malaria program, rate of absenteeism was reduced to 2 to 4%. And nearly one-fourth fewer laborers were required for any given task. So although one could argue that economic growth has to accelerate the eradication of poverty, many economists felt that its impact occurred too slowly. So in other words, many tend to believe in an instantaneous trickle-down effect of economic growth, and subsequently a more direct method of poverty reduction. So namely, basic needs approach was advocated. It enables the direct fulfillment of basic needs such as a health, clothing, such as health, clothing, and sanitation, shelter, nutrition, and also education. So what do we term as major determinants of poor health? So the following are some of the main determinants of poor health which have direct or indirect interdependence with economic development. We do have sanitary condition and inadequate shelter. We do have education. We have nutrition and also have population growth. In terms of rapid population growth implies an increased need for medical and other social services. So there remains a debate on the relation between health status improvements and economic growth. It is clear that health status usually improves or improvements are attained at the expense of fixed capital, entailing a smaller economic growth. Again, you find that investment funds that could have been used for the growth of the economy are largely used for investments in the health service sector, which has in a part of consumption capital. Some argue, however, that they do argue that investment is basic research as health service sector in the health service sector, which has in part a consumption character. So at the end of the day, investment in basic needs such as in the health service are investment in human capital, which in turn is growth promoting. Although some tend to conclude that there is a positive relationship between health and economic development, this does not prove that improvement of the health service sector is a sufficient condition for economic development. On the other hand, a better health status does not guarantee a fast economic growth. The following conclusions may be drawn from the discussions of the relationship between health and development. One, that development is not a simple process. It's a complex. Intermingling of economic, social, environmental, physiological, psychic, cultural, and even political factors. Then the measurement of development is not easy. It's not an easy task. Economists provide certain tools which can be brought to bear on crucial areas where decisions are required. Further research is required in these areas so as to develop tools and techniques for evaluation in those areas that are not readily quantifiable. Again, we find that development links just to the improvement of economic indicators or the attainment of the basic needs, but with wider aspirations such as high health status and with social well-being and change, development processes embrace not only the so-called productive sectors of the economy, but also the social sectors. And lastly, but not least, that we have review questions in terms of in what sense are the consumers of health ignorant? And also we find that economic development is a process. What are the necessary situations for a given country to be considered that it is in this process? Now, as a subject, I know that you're now able to explain the major determinants of poor health in a developing country. Also explain some of those aspects in terms of in relation to economics, the health economics, and the country's development. That's what we had for today. I want to be there is something we've grasped. Again, go through your notes, go through the URL links that I've given, and you can be able to understand further this subject. And it shall be well. So until the next class, see you then.